Okay, and welcome everybody. So this is section 14, where we will discuss more about model selection for linear regression. And that continues from the previous section. In the previous section, we discussed in more general terms what are the effects of choosing a too large model or a too small model, and we had a list of criteria to assess how good is a given model. But we didn't actually get to the point of how to do it. And that's what we will fill in this section. So in this section, the main thing we are going to discuss is an algorithm for choosing one of a large group of possible models for a given data set. And the idea is easy, namely for each input, we can either include it or not include it, and we just try all possible combinations and use one of the criteria from the previous section to decide which one is best. But there's a problem, namely, if you know combinatorics, you know that if you have a list of things and p inputs in our case, and each is either included or not included, that is 2 to the p possible combinations, and that grows exponentially in p, and for even moderate p, that can be quite a large number of models to try, though that gets a bit slow. And the main aim of this section is to explain an algorithm which can make the search faster by excluding large parts of the search space and requiring only to fit a much smaller number of models. Okay, so the details are all written down in the notes. And in this video, I'm just explaining the main ideas of this, hopefully giving you a sense of how that works. And the plan is that afterwards, when you get the idea, then you go back to the notes and read all the details to get it all lined up properly. Okay, so main ideas. Let's see what we can do. So there is a number of things we need to think about. The first is, how do we actually represent our models? So far we had y is beta 0 plus beta 1 x1 and so on up to beta p xp and the error. And now I'm saying we are selecting a subset of these variables. So the models we are going to try, one of them would be y is just beta 0 plus epsilon, and one of them will be y is beta 0 plus beta 2 x2 plus beta 4 x4 plus epsilon and so on. So there are lots of models. And one has a choice here. One can also try out whether the intercept is in the model or not, but I'm not going to do that here. So I assume the intercept is in all of my models. So this one here is the largest, that has all terms, and that one here is the smallest, that has only the intercept. And there are p inputs, each of which can be in or not in. So what we have is we have 2 to the p possible models. And we need to now think, if I'm going to write the algorithm or formulas or a computer program, how do I actually say which model is in? So in this list, if I want to continue and enumerate L models, I need to do this somehow. And for the theory, I want to do that just by giving the indices of the variables which are included. So J is the subset of the indices 1 up to P, and that represents the model with variables xj, where j is in capital J only. So these are in and the others are out. So just to try out that notation, then the first model has all variables. So here we have j is indices of all variables which are in. So that's all numbers from 1 to p. And this model has no variables. So here j would be the empty set. And here j would be 2 and 4. Good, so that is notation for the theory. And in R, when I code this whole thing, I want to do something very similar, namely in R, I use a vector of integers. For example, j could then be c 2, 4 for the third model written here. Or I just write a vector of indices which are included in increasing order. So there are different ways of doing that, but that's the way I've chosen, and when I tried that, that worked out quite nicely, both for writing it down and for writing the R code. Good, so that's the first problem to solve. Then, For a given j, we can fit the model, which is like I just said. So y is now beta 0, I want to include always, and sum j in j, beta j xj plus the error. And then I get fitted values y hat. And with these, we can now compute either r squared values or the residual sum of squares. And what I want to do here is I want to minimize our estimator for the variance, so that sigma hat squared we computed. And if we think what that is, so first that will depend on the model. So I write sigma hat squared of j, and that was 1 over n minus p minus 1. And p was the number of variables, so that is now the size of the set j. So n minus size of j minus 1. And then it was the residual sum of squares, so sum I from 1 to n, yi minus y hat I squared. And we have seen in the notes for models with an intercept good, so we can do either of these two, but that here is the formula I'm going to use. So whatever you want to do, it's equivalent, so you can just pick which one, and I'm going to minimize sigma hat squared. Good, and now you see there are two terms here. There is this term which says how well does the model fit, and that we have seen gets easier if you add new inputs. So if you add new inputs, the optimal model gets smaller always, stays the same or gets smaller. So adding variables makes that term here smaller. But then there it is 1 over n minus p minus 1, or in our new notation, 1 over n minus size of model minus 1. And that's, of course, a penalty for the complexity of the model. So the more variables there are, the smaller the number I divide by, and then the whole thing gets bigger, and I want to minimize it, so it getting bigger is not a good thing. That makes the value smaller if I add variables, but that makes it bigger if I add variables, and that trade-off is really what we are considering here. Good, and there's now the main trick of the whole endeavor, namely, if we consider models of a given size, then we can just look at the residual sum of squares. So that is, well, let me write it with my new notation. We want the minimum of this sigma hat squared of j over all models. So that is how small can we make this estimated residual error, the variance of it, if I minimize over all models. And I can first minimize over all models of a given size. So I give myself the size. Q could be anything from 0 up to p. And then I minimize over models of the size. So minimum over all j, where the size of the model is q. The model includes q variables. And then I do sigma hat squared j. And nothing has happened here. That minimum and these two minima, they are over exactly the same space. Only I've now sliced it by how large are the models. So here I do all models with q variables, and then I also consider all variables, and these two minimas are the same as that one minima which goes over all models at once. Good. And there's an advantage to that. Namely, I can now write what sigma hat squared is. And we have just seen that. That is 1 over n minus size of j minus 1 times the residual sum of squared. Let's just write r for that. R of j, where r of j is defined as sum I from 1 to n, yi minus y hat I squared. And it is implied here these y hat are for the model which is described by j. Okay, so I can write it like this. And because I said the models have size q, so size of j here, that thing, I can replace with a q. And then I can take the whole expression and move it out here. So what we get is we get minimum over all q, then 1 over n minus q minus 1, and then the minimum over all j, which have size q, r of j. And that seems not so useful at first, but it turns out it is. And the advantage is we have cut the problem into two, namely here we need to compare only models of a fixed size, though that means we don't need the penalty term, we can just use the residual sum of squares, and in a second I'll talk about how that's a bit easier. And then once we have done that, if we have found the model for each size, then that minimum is much easier. So there are lots of models of size 5, say, if there are 10 variables, but here that's just p plus 1 different numbers we find the minimum of. So once we have done that, we just go through the list and find the minimum, no problem, because the maximum anybody would consider for the kind of models we are discussing here, maybe 100 variables, less than I would think. For big models, people probably use neural networks or something, but here I would think that's a minimum of less than 100 numbers, so that will take no time whatsoever for the computer. Good, so we need to only find the minimum of the residual sum of squares for models of a given size. Good, and before we do that, there is another idea. Namely, I said the residual sum of squares has this monotony. If I add variables, it gets smaller. So if a model J has fewer variables than a model K, in my set notations, it means the set J is smaller than the set K, then the residual sum of squares for model J must be bigger or equal to the residual sum of squares for model K, because K adds variables that allows the model to fit better to the data, so the residual sum of squares can only go down. And that again looks like a relatively trivial observation, but using that observation we can sometimes tell that the residual sum of squares must be larger than some value we know. So if we have worked out the residual sum of squares for model K, then we have a bound for lots of other models. So if we remove more variables, then we know the value will get even larger. So we can sometimes then exclude models by arguing they have no chance to be the minimum here without actually fitting the model, just by saying that's a model we already have considered earlier with variables removed. So the value we get must be worse than what we got before, and before was not good enough, so now it has no chance of being the minimum. And this simple looking trick, that's what will save work in the algorithm. Good, so that is the main ideas we will be working with, and because the algorithm is quite complex, I'll discuss this in a separate video. So see you in a minute in the next video.